My topic today is epilepsy, social, occupational, and women's issues, which is a more practical topic that we come across during treatment of these patients. So epilepsy is one of the most common chronic non-communicable neurological disorder. It's affecting most of the patients in globally, and it does not affect or not, that does not spare any of the age groups, even the children, the teenage, young adults, working group, and then elderly are all being affected to a certain extent. So about 70% of epilepsy can be treated without much of a complications. And again, there are about very important that 80% of these epilepsy patients who are living in low and middle income group of countries globally. And most of these patients has a lot of problems of finding the treatment for epilepsy, and they are living with the lot of social issues. The risk of premature death is 3 to 6 times higher than of the general public in the patients with epilepsy. So what are the important impacts in epilepsy? So as I told earlier, so 80% of them are living in the low and the middle income countries, and 75% does not get proper treatment in an adequate time period. And there are so many factors which play a role in preventing them getting the desired treatment. Because of these, the World Health Assembly adopted the resolution on epilepsy in last year, 2020, to improve the health, the learning of the healthcare providers to reduce the epilepsy treatment gap, and also to find a better solution and public awareness activities to reduce the misconception of epilepsy. So what we know about treatment gap in this, if you look at this graph here, even Sri Lanka, we are coming under the low middle income country. So about 50% of our patients who diagnose having epilepsy come late to get the treatment. And that is more common in the low income groups, and the high income groups, especially the Singapore, they get the proper treatment as early as possible. What are the reasons for this? They're having lack of awareness of treatability. We have poor accessibility to healthcare facilities. It may be the low doctor-patient ratio, and we have been with the crowd clearing approach. Cost of medication matters a lot to the patients. And on top of that, the Asian countries where we live, we have a lot of misbeliefs regarding the epilepsy. We sometimes think it is a supernatural power causing this abnormal behavior. We may be having faith on other type of treatments, and some people tend to deny, or and they have the fear of social stigmata of diagnosing having epilepsy, and many of them do not get a continued medical education. Right, point one. The diagnosis of epilepsy. I feel this is very important, and during last some topics discussion that we heard a lot about in details of how one should diagnose epilepsy. But again, I thought it's very important to discuss here again. So operational classification of epilepsy, which came from the ILEA, they identified that at least 3 important criteria. So one to diagnose epilepsy should have at least 2 unprovoked seizures or reflex seizures occurring more than 24 hours apart. Or it may be on 1 unprovoked seizures, but that has brain has the history cerebral insult, which causes about causes about 60% of recurrence rate of seizures within next 10 years. Or you may diagnose epilepsy syndrome. And this is been adapted in most of the centers and most where that when you are dealing with the epilepsy patients. And we discuss about this classification of epilepsy. I'm not going to go into the details, but this is important because when to diagnose epilepsy, you should be able to definitely identify the problems we are dealing with. So we talk about the seizure types, then we wanted to diagnose what are the types of epilepsy the person is dealing with, whether we can put it into the epilepsy syndrome, and whether we can identify any of the etiologies or whether there are other comorbids. Because when you are providing treatment and when you are advising the patients who comes with epilepsy, we'll have to consider all these things, all these factors to be identified during epilepsy care. And what are the important points and the diagnosis of a seizure or epilepsy is depending mainly on the detailed focus history. How can we do that? We do it in the either outpatient clinics, but in a certain instances, the busy outpatient clinic will not be able to provide the adequate time for one to sit and take the history. And if we encourage the patients to have the eyewitness to come together, and possibly if we can record if they can record an event to bring them across. So these particular points are valuable in making of giving the advice to the patients who comes with so much of questions with what is going to happen to them in further many years. But similarly, we have to understand there are a lot of things which can mimic epilepsy. Syncopal, maybe the vasovagal or a cardiac. Vasovagal syncopies are common in children. Maybe of a metabolic causes like hypoglycemia or the calcium abnormalities. Sometimes even the migraine can manifest as the, especially with the migraine aura, can misdiagnose as a possible the focal onset seizures. And never forget of the psychogenic non-epileptic attack disorders, because making the diagnosis of such prevent you giving the patients providing so much of anti-epileptic medications. There are many other things of alcohol or CNS toxins, or then we, especially of a patient coming with seizures or possibly of the abnormal events during sleep, maybe of a sleep-related paroxysmal events. So one has to think about all these things. So because of that, this is the important guideline which is adopted in many of the centers, is how we diagnose epilepsy. Ideally, of a patient who comes with the first seizure to you or where, to the outpatient or to the normal clinics, all these patients should be referred urgently to the specialist. It may be of a specialist who has an interest or a training and expertise with epilepsy. Maybe a pediatrician, maybe a physician with special interest of epilepsy, or a neurologist with special interest of epilepsy, or be an expertise in epilepsy. If the diagnosis cannot be clearly established, the referral to tertiary epilepsy specialist is always recommended. Point two, that what are the social issues in epilepsy? We just look at. So this may be a problem that we come across where we are advising all these patients. Maybe parents will be worried about the child education, an adult person who may be worried about his employment, social interests, and marriage, and so forth. There's a lot of things. And each and everywhere that we have to consider the patient-centered and the caregiver-centered approach in addressing all these issues. Right. The education. Education is the key to success. What we can offer to a child who is having epilepsy? So every child has a right to educate themselves or right to learn as they want. But a child with epilepsy may require sometimes special attention. They may be slow learners. They may be having other neurological disabilities. There may be a lot of behavioral abnormalities. They may be bombarded with the anti-epileptic drug effects. And not only that, these children are often is overprotected and they become over-dependent because of this overprotection. So all these factors to be addressed with the parents, caregivers, especially of the preschool teachers and the teachers as well. And a medical professional needs to work together to help them to promote the proper, better environment at home or at daycare centers, preschool or at school. Because we sometimes come across the children who are coming with epilepsy, having attacks at schools, the teachers ask them, please don't come to school. You get your disease cured and come to school. So this should not be the way that we should tackle these patients. So we adopt the child-friendly concept, and it's important to educate the teacher about the child's condition. It can be done by the parents, or in case necessary, we may need to intervene by as a medical professionals. So can advise them to adjust the child's environment. If we can provide a safe spot in the classroom, that is very good, where the child can be rested during or soon after the epileptic attack. And basically, the teachers and the classmates should know at least the basic first aids in kids, what to do and what not to do. All become panic when you see a seizure and they run around, they try to put something into the mouth, they hold some iron bars and so forth. This may be detrimental to of these patients. And what we should do is we have to encourage these children to be incorporated in the day-to-day activities of life. We encourage the participation and encourage the independence. Again, we have to address the wrong beliefs. Sometimes the people think that the epileptic patient may have a subnormal IQ or they show the negative attitudes towards the patient. So we have to do what? We deliver the positive approach. We have to reassure the everybody, the child, the parents, or the school teacher, or whoever the caregiver, this is a temporary and self-limiting condition, and they become better or they become normal after the attack. So we have to respect the child fairness, and we have to inform the staff to recognize children. They are coming with and some difficulty, but they are to be involved in the classroom activities. Point four, the sports and the epilepsy. That is again something very important to discuss, because all these school children or even the teenagers and even the young adults wanted to know what we can do, what are the leisures, what are the sports we can do. You probably would know, identify these two great figures. They mark their names in the international sports arenas. One is from the running and one is from the cricket. Right. So they all did their sports up to the maximum. So most sports are safe for people with epilepsy. Even seizures aren't fully controlled, but they will have to adapt their life. They'll have to be strict to their anti-epileptic drug compliance. They'll be used to have wearing safety gears in certain kind of sports like bike riding, or sometimes it's just hiking like things. Even they are not prohibited in doing the water sports. Even the swimming can be allowed, but with some cautions. Always to be in a swimming pool. Do not allow the open water swimming, but to be with the coach and also to arrange a possible the person who knows about the basic life-saving techniques if somebody has a seizure in the water. So what are the sports which does not have any additional risk? If you engage in these, the patient will not have an additional risk of their life. Athletics, bowling, most of the contact sports, judo, wrestling, even can be encouraged. And if basketball, baseball, cricket, field hockey, football, rugby, volleyball, all of these sports can be considered as a safety sports for the anybody who is doing involving all these. So other ones are important ones are the racket sports where there's people are very interested. But there are other groups of sports like those carry the moderate risk to the people living with epilepsy, and these are the important ones. The especially of swimming, water skiing, hiking, even gymnastics, cycling. So you have to have the protective measures available. But the group three sports, which are actually is not encouraged, such as aviation, diving, horse riding, scuba diving, sky jumping, solitary sailing, or surfing and windsurfing, because this can be of a danger to your life. The next point is the employment. What can we tell about the employment? So having the epilepsy is does not necessarily stop someone from doing the job they want, but there are restrictions for that. But there may be a lot of issues at the workplace with being absent for a longer period or having this epilepsy or seizures at workplace, which causes alarm to the rest of the team. An ideal job would supposed to be of an office job with low risk of injuries. And what's important impact of epilepsy? That we understand that the patients, people with epilepsy, earn less than the rest of the normal people. So, unemployment is common in epilepsy patients just because of the many reasons. Patient does not want to be employed for some reason or the other. The family may be overprotecting the patients, don't allowing them to work. Employees are not happy to have the patients with epilepsy. Certain jobs are not suitable for the epileptic patients. And sometimes these epileptic patients, we do not get the adequate vocational training, even in the schools, and no, some do not get the proper social support, and school dropouts are very common in epilepsy. So, but what is important to know, there are certain jobs are not considered in epilepsy patients. Those called the safety sensitive jobs, such as air traffic controllers, firefighters, pilots and other airline positions, border patrol agents and armed forces, commercial truck drivers and machine operators, which may endanger their life. Next question. How can we live with epilepsy and driving? What are the advices and what are the evidence we do have? Can epilepsy patient drive? If it is, if they can drive, what should they know? Actually, the driving is a privilege for independent living. Many people, they enjoy driving as well as it's become a very attractive, lucrative job in certain type of driving. So, but what is important to know? That this should have the capacity to make a quick decision, anticipation of any road safeties, that they should be able to execute fine motor tasks quickly during an accident. So patient with epilepsy or having ORAs even or anti-epileptic drugs, both contribute to the skills function. What is practice in Sri Lanka? So we have very limited reports available. What we have identified in one of them is some time back, long time back, it was about 2000. Sri Lanka, the driving license is asked only on the history of epilepsy. When you are applying for the driving license, they ask whether you have epilepsy or any neurological abnormality. Nothing else being looked for in issuing the driving license. If you answer that it's no, your license is being considered or license being issued. But if you declare that you had the seizures, the driving license, for one to have the driving license in Sri Lanka, you should be a person of fit free period for 2 years. That's the only thing we look in issuing the driving license in Sri Lanka. But this practice has a very lot of deficiencies considering the road traffic accidents now we see, and especially with the improvement of the road structure. So what are the regulations in other developing countries or developed countries? This is the most important thing in the ILA recommendation, which came from the European driving license authorities. They identified just two groups. Group one is the persons who uses personal vehicles, maybe the cars, vans, motorcycles, the personal use. So if you declared epilepsy, you have to be of a 1 year seizure-free period for you to have your driving license. And first and a single unprovoked seizure, you can have your driving license and you can drive after 6 months of seizure-free period. The group two, that is for the passenger vehicles, buses, trucks, and heavy goods vehicles, they had to be of not having epilepsy for 10 years without any anti-epileptic drugs to get your driving license back. If you had a first order single unprovoked seizure, you can carry a driving license for group two after waiting for 5 years. The issues with women and epilepsy. What are the important points? Sometimes you come across the patients with epilepsy, especially women, having increased seizures that's very close to the menstrual period. That is because the steroid hormones, sex hormones, especially the estrogens, causes seizures where the progesterone is its negative effect, it is anticonvulsive. So because of this hormonal imbalance, sometimes women with epilepsy tend to show clustering of seizures during a certain period of menstrual period. It may be pre or post menstrual period, or maybe related to the luteal phase. The treatment of these patients are a little difficult. They do not respond to the conventional, the common anti-epileptic drugs they are on. And usually it's do respond well to of intermittent use of benzodiazepines or acetazolamide, sometimes even the progesterone. What do we know about the anti-epileptic drugs and the contraception? Commonly used anti-epileptic drugs has impacts on drug metabolisms, especially those who induce the liver enzymes. That's the common drugs are the carbamazepine, lamotrigine, oxycarbazepine, phenobarbital, phenytoin, primidone, and even topiramate. So all these, the patients who are on any of these drugs, the combined oral contraceptive pill may not give you adequate protection. In such case, we may have to consider the higher doses of estrogen. Always encounter or barrier methods, and sometimes even the intrauterine hormonal releasing devices, which acts locally, would provide better protection than of oral contraceptive pill. What are the other issues in women with epilepsy? They can often be subfertile. They may have the premature menopause. A lot of problems with the bone health of osteoporosis and osteomalacia. And again, these anti-epileptic drugs affects the vitamin D metabolism. And we have to advise of a regular monitoring of vitamin D levels and vitamin D supplementation, as well as assessing their possibility of osteoporosis by DEXA scans. Next point is pregnancy. So epilepsy and pregnancy is a highly discussed topic in most of the forums. What are the advices we can do? One is the important points are there's pre-pregnancy counseling. Have to counsel the women as well as the family of what we should do. It should be of even before person getting pregnant. You have to have the optimized anti-epileptic medications before conception. You have to advise on the anti-epileptic drug compliance. Just try to be on the monotherapy as much as possible. We may have to change to the drugs to a better, safer drug, such as lamotrigine, levetiracetam, or carbamazepine. Always to inform the possible tetrogenicity of anti-epileptic drugs. It's common in polytherapy than in monotherapy. And the pre-pregnancy and pregnancy folic acid supplementation. It has to be about 5 milligrams of folic acid per day for a person who is preparing for pregnancy while on anti-epileptic drugs. Again, to eliminate the other risk factors such as smoking, the drugs, and alcohol. So if a woman with epilepsy was treated with seizure medication, risk of the birth defects is increased up to nearly of a 7 now. The most common malformations who exposed to seizure medication in utero are the cardiac. And next up is the neural tube defects, a cleft palate, skeletal and urological abnormalities. Neural tube defects are common in patients who are exposed to valproic acid. It's more than 700 milligrams per day of valproic acid increases the high risk of neural tube defects. Not only that, there are a lot of reports coming up now. The babies can have a cognitive and a behavioral impairment later in life. And the autistic spectrum disorders are common in these people. So this just diagram of how this the antiepileptic drugs affects the causes of major congenital abnormalities. And what is important is even though we discussed as the carbamazepine or amitriptyline are safe, they do have their possible risk. So what we should do during pregnancy? So early antenatal referral leads is indicated. They need to be assessed by the biochic and as well as by the physician or the neurologist in the first trimester of pregnancy. We have to consider of possible major malformations, and ultrasound scans by 12 weeks and 20 weeks are indicated. And sometimes the efficacy of antiepileptic drugs become less because of the volume expansion during second and third trimester. You may have to change or increase the level of the antiepileptic drugs, especially after the carbamazepine or the lamotrigine it's been on. And vitamin K supplements at the last month of last trimester is very important in preventing the hemorrhage in the newborn. And the method of delivery is always depend on the obstetric need, but one may has to advise on pain management during labor, because sometimes these patients can have induced seizure with pain. What we can tell about the breastfeeding? So this is what is we identified. There are certain antiepileptics that can treat in the breast milk, but considering the volume the child drink, it's going to be very less. But when it comes to a certain antiepileptics like lamotrigine, if you have increased the lamotrigine of a higher to higher level during the latter part of the pregnancy, we may have to reduce the lamotrigine levels, lamotrigine dose, soon after the delivery. What we can do, we have to encourage the breastfeeding, but we try to reduce the dose of antiepileptic drugs. So what are the advices we can tell them if you are feeding? So take the medicines just once a day if possible. Try to take it at the beginning of the baby's long sleep interval or usually right after the bedtime feeding. If you're taking drugs twice or more than once daily, to feed the baby immediately before you take the dose. Sometimes you may have to think about supplemental breastfeeding, because especially during the night, wake up might disturb the sleep, the seizures. So epilepsy and elderly. So elderly population do also can have a high incidence of epilepsy because of the certain factors. They live long, they may be having multiple comorbids that contributes mostly to the seizures, such as even the ischemic brain insult, neurodegenerative diseases, hepatic or renal metabolic dysfunctions. Again, it's a diagnosis is challenge because they can presents with atypical presentation. Focal seizures are common in elderly, and again with a certain degree of cognitive impairment, a dementia, the patient will not provide adequate history, or may can have even sometimes non-convulsive status, and they may be living in isolation. They may have poor access to medical care. All these factors delivers that patient will not be offered treated properly. Again, the treatment of antiepileptic drugs is a challenge on these patients. It's very difficult to select the correct antiepileptic drugs with a lot of complications. such as a patient who is having cardiac problems on warfarin, we have to be we consider of using the antiepileptic drug which does not affect the warfarin metabolism. So these are the factors which we have to consider in addressing the patient, elderly patient. Right, I think I come to the last point of my talk. It's the, as medical professionals, what are our responsibilities? So we are there to provide the adequate awareness and education to the public having epilepsy. We have our responsibility of proper counseling the parents, caregivers, school teachers, staff training, and workplace. We should get involved in the mass media education, social media campaign, in educating the public on how to live with epilepsy. I suggest a regular workshop for healthcare workers, social care workers, and people in rescue forces to identify the seizures and first aid in seizures. So always encourage support group assistance. I think I have come to the end of my talk, and thank you for the ASN giving me this opportunity to talk in something which is practical and more important in addressing the epilepsy patients. The pearls, you can expand up to what you want, but I consider the correct diagnosis, the recognizing the social issues, what recommendations we can provide on education and sports, cuts on employment and driving, issues pertaining to the women and a safe pregnancy, and our responsibilities with the important pearls for me, and we can expand as what you want. Thank you.